Now I'm going to define the parser, and I want it to have this signature. I'm going to define a function parse, which takes a symbol, saying I want to parse something like an expression. It takes text that we're going to parse, and it takes the grammar that defines that symbol and all the other symbols. I want it to return. When we had regular expressions, we looked at returning a set of remainders. I'm going to have this return a single remainder. And the idea is that we want the author of the grammar to have some control over what's going on and make this grammar be unambiguous so that there's a single result for each parse rather than having to keep a set of results. And the idea is that for each symbol, we're going to consider the alternatives in left to right order. So we're going to first say, if we're asked to parse an expression, we'll say, can we parse this alternative? And if we can parse in succession a term and then a plus or minus or then an expression, then we'll commit to that and we'll say, that's the result we're going to return, that's the single remainder, and we're not going to even explore the other alternatives. And because we have this left to right choice, that's why we decide to write the expressions in this order, and we don't write them in the opposite order, because if we wrote the rule this way, and we were trying to parse the expression a plus 3, we'd be asked to parse this, we'd try to parse a term, we'd say yes, a is a term, and then we'd stop, and we'd say that's the end. We wouldn't even consider parsing off the term plus the expression. This is no good. It's up to the author of the grammar to write rules in the correct order so that the longest thing gets tried first. Our regular expression functions were what it's known as recognizers, and they told us yes or no is a string part of the language. And here what we're doing is different. It's a parser. So it tells you yes or no, is it part of the language, but then it also gives you an internal structure, a tree structure of the parts of the expression. So here it would be a plus 3. If we had m times x plus b, then that would parse into a structure that had m times x plus b. And so here I said we were returning a remainder, but actually I want to return a two-element tuple of the tree followed by the remainder. And here's what we're going for. If I ask to parse the expression a times x with the grammar g, I want to get back this tree structure. And it looks kind of complicated. All it's really saying is that we have an a in the first element, then the multiply sign, and then an x in the third element, and there's no remainder, we parse the whole string. That's what it says, but there's all these intermediate parts here because that's the way the grammar is defined. And I should say here that this is a tree comma remainder result. We're going to use the convention that fail corresponds to a value of none. So let's think then about what we have to do to be able to parse a text. I can think of four cases that we have to deal with. One, we want to be able to parse an expression or a symbol like the expression keyword. And to do that, we've got to be able to look that up in the grammar G. We've also got to be able to parse a regular expression, plus or minus. And we've seen how to do that before, so we've reduced that to a solved problem. We're going to have to be able to parse a tuple of alternatives. Here, one alternative or another alternative done in left to right order. And finally, we're going to have to be able to parse a list of atoms representing a sequence, 1, 2, 3. Now I'm going to tell you the plan for how we're going to implement this as code within the function parse. So this first case, I'm going to handle with a subroutine called parseAtom. So this is an atom expression. We should be able to handle that. The second part, the regular expression, is, well, it's a type of atom, so it occurs within the parseAtom routine. We're going to define a variable called tokenizer to help us do that. And then we're going to use the built-in re.match along with the tokenizer to recognize those regular expressions. Then for the alternatives, tuple of alternatives is what you get when you look up the symbol like expression in the grammar. And so I could have had a separate function called parse alternatives, but instead I just decided to have that be part of parseAtom because it was so simple. It was just an immediate step to go from the symbol to the list of alternatives. Finally, to parse the sequence of atoms, I have a subroutine or function called parseSequence.